We will move to our final presentation because we have heard many things about how to use this, what is the principle and theoretical aspects, ethical aspects, technical aspects, etc. But we have never talked about potential teaching. We may heard some essentials about there are some requirements for the teaching system, but in the moment I will welcome our colleague Karel Šafr from Unicorn University, who will speak about, or we will discuss about the problems of how to teach AI at university level. Actually, he cannot be here, so it is again pre-recorded, so you can watch it, but I will be here to actually answer any question towards him. So I ask for the recording.
We have heard today a lot of presentation about machine learning, their utilization, future of the machine learning and artificial intelligence. And now is the time to talk about how to teach it, how to teach students to use and to understand the principles of machine learning and artificial intelligence. And for that, I'm happy to welcome Karel Šafr here, my colleague from Unicorn University, and ask him, so how do we teach?
Thank you so much, David, for having me. Let me introduce you my presentation. I will speak today about how we teach machine learning and artificial intelligence. So I will introduce you our framework, how we teach artificial intelligence in our university. Then we will speak or discuss the programming languages and their context in IE education, because it's quite an interesting story. Then we will move to our courses, and I will introduce you the our bachelor and master courses, which is relevant to artificial intelligence. And then we will end with three examples of a project, what we done with our students. And that's all. That's my presentation. So some little info about me. I obtained PhD in statistics. I have quite big experience in grant research as a mathematician, and my area of expertise is mathematical and statistical methods and their implementation. So it's math combined with programming.
Okay, so I see that, and I know, of course, that you are well trained and having capabilities to teach. But it's interesting because it's not very easy to teach AI, right? So to create new experts that understand deeply what to use, when to use it. So I'm interested how it is structured. I mean, what are all the components? How they are structured together?
Yeah. That's quite an interesting story because the framework of teaching artificial intelligence is quite a complicated area. There are several problems which arise immediately after you thinking about it. The first problem is something like how to update it, because the artificial intelligence and machine learning quickly change. So we have to react immediately on the change on market and on change on internet, and teach the relevant stuff. So our courses are spread to bachelor and master degree. We have several courses in bachelor degree, which are relevant to artificial intelligence. There are quite a lot of courses that are mathematical prerequisites for study this subject. We have mathematical analysis, for example, linear algebra, which you like, and yep. We have optimization. And then we have quite interesting course, which is artificial intelligence on our bachelor degree. Then on the master degree, there is a specialization called software engineering and big data. There are several subjects. We have statistical methods in data analysis, which is statistics and machine learning. Then we have data mining, mathematics, and algorithm, and I think you will like this subject. And we have introduction to machine learning, which I teach. Then I will mention additional courses which we are preparing now. These courses will be in your accreditation, and we will speak about them later.
Okay, and when you know students approach for the first time, or maybe even the users of AI tools, they are starting to asking about programming languages. So, what to start with? What is the best language? So, what?
Yeah, that's another quite interesting story, because there's a battle between languages. It's a battle between R and Python. especially in private sector, there are a lot of people which prefer Python and argue that one or other language is better. We did not decide that one language is better, and we teach both of them. And I think that's really good because each year it's different. Who looks that who's won? So we teach R and Python, but mainly on courses which looks like statistics or courses which is relevant to statistical methods. We teach R. And on courses which looks like mainly as machine learning or artificial intelligence, we teach Python. That's not because it's impossible to do machine learning or artificial intelligence in R, but that's because mainly on market and companies prefer to use Python in machine learning. And on other side, the companies related to financial sectors and which do mainly something like regression, time series methods, the statistical stuff, they mainly use R. So in that case, we prefer to teach R because it looks more convenient in this way.
Yeah, and if we have this programming languages and we have heard about some machine learning already, and probably there will be some math, I see. So what are the prerequisites for students when entering the university and trying to teach?
Yeah, that's quite interesting. I thought our primary focus is on the practical teaching of artificial intelligence. We also teach subject related to math and to the theoretical aspects of artificial intelligence. So we have on bachelor degree, we have several subjects related to, especially the mathematical analysis, which is very important to know where is the maximum, where is the minimum function. Then we have discrete mathematics, that's also very important, especially for algorithm and other stuff. Then we have statistical analysis, that's extremely important, and advanced algorithm development. That's a mathematical background for our students, how to they learn the mathematical stuff related to AI. On master degree, because not all our students, especially on master degree, are from our bachelor, we have a lot of new students. So on master degree, we have applied optimization. That's the core of the how to obtain the coefficient in neural network and in other methods. And we have one subject which is not mentioned there, but I will have slides about them, the mathematical background for this stuff. And that's something like a review for our students how to obtain the knowledge which they did not saw on their bachelor degree.
So okay, so maybe, you know, that's the mathematical requirement, and I'm sure that there are mathematical courses and we will speak about that, but let's start with something that, you know, yeah, Students are happy to and they are interested in. So what are the actual AI courses that we
have? Actual AI courses, there's the first AI course, it's on bachelor degree, that's it's called artificial intelligence, not surprisingly. And this course mapped the history of artificial intelligence, introduced to students what's agent, what's intelligent agents, what's intelligence, and the key concept of AI. This course is taught within the bachelor program and covers the general foundation of artificial intelligence. And by completing this course, students gain general overview of the tools and methods used in artificial intelligence. So it's something like the basic 001 course for them. Yeah.
Okay. And so that's artificial intelligence. Is there anything more like in the components of the student? Because if we are at the bachelor degree or bachelor level, what other courses make all the components?
On bachelor level. Yeah. On bachelor level, there are several more courses, but they are mainly related to algorithm.
And, I see.
But we have a statistical course on our bachelor degree, which covers the basic of statistics, what they need for AI and machine learning, but just the basic. Mm-hmm. But on master degree, we have another course, which is called Statistical Methods in Data Analysis. And this course is a comprehensive course on statistics for master degree. And it starts with the basic, but with intermediate methods like regression, logistic regression, box Jenkins methods, the time series, the cluster analysis, discriminant. And it covers also the decision regression trees and ensemble methods. So it's a mixture of advanced statistical methods and the basic machine learning methods. And it introduced to students both this world, especially from the statistic point of view, because when we teach and when we speak about artificial intelligence, it's important to mention it that it can be viewed from several angles, for several point of view. It can be viewed from IT, it can be viewed from math, and it can be viewed from the statistical point of view. And it's very important to mention the statistical machine learning.
Yes, I mean, that's maybe a good question, really, because I'm experiencing myself this when teaching math. How do you like comment on for students asking, come on, I mean, I have assigned for machine learning and artificial intelligence. I would like to program. I'm happy to learn programming languages. I'm happy to learn all the machine learning method. Why am I having this course of statistics, which is, or maybe they will actually comment on that it's old and boring. Yeah. So how would you comment on this?
Yeah. This is a general question, I think, because they like the programming courses, they like the AI courses, because it sounds cool and it makes them a little more cool. And but the statistics, statistics sounds boring, but statistics, it's a background. It's a background of AI, it's a background of machine learning. And it's very important to know the basics and the background of these methods, because when we look on for example, on decision trees or on neural networks, the basic behind the these methods are math, programming, and statistics. And you have to know everything from it, at least something from it, to be able to do this stuff properly. For example, you have to know how to program stuff. Because without programming, you will not be able to create neural network. But without statistic background, you will don't know how to prepare data, how to clean the data, how to find the inference which you need for converting data and transformation, data transformation. It's a really important part of neural network. And
all this may be interesting. Are you facing sometimes a situation where you like show students that, okay, this problem is so specific that it's better to actually use some classical statistical method rather than big machine learning method?
That's a real life case, because it's often some strange data sets which have some strange properties. For example, they have a really lot of columns and few rows. And for example, in this case, it's important to prepare data, properly for your analysis. And we have, for example, the principal component analysis or factor analysis to create a new variable from the old, the change the dimension of the data set to something different, and to prepare it for neural network or to prepare it for support vector machines.
Okay, so that sounds cool that you combine both these. So, and what about, we did have a statistic, what about the general math?
I mean,
what about
the math? On our master degree, there is one course which I mentioned you like it because you are teaching it. And it's data mining, mathematics, and algorithm. And that's the background of our knowledge in mathematics, and I think you will say us something.
Yeah, probably. That was a clever question because I was asking to ping pong the question to me. Well, the idea of the course, in fact, is to look at the problems of machine learning from the viewpoint of this optimization or algorithmic way. So you're going to say, okay, look, you have a particular setting, particular problem. You are well able to actually design the problem in sense of mathematical model and then to solve it. So we are trying to teach students how to design problems. So these problems then could be plugged in to solver, and the solver do the job for you. But in designing the problem, precise way that you understand everything, and then you understand that all the conditions you put in are correct, is not always easy, and that's what we are teaching. So we start from very simple linear programming, and we are teaching integer programming that is hard, and nonlinear programming. We are looking for the graph theoretical concept and looking for the complexity of algorithms and working with all these corresponding notions. That one of the aspects I would say about the math is also that something could be very long, right? You're computing. Maybe you have a big cluster, but even though you have cluster, it could be very long computation. So we are trying to teach them, okay, it's better to find a different description of the problem, and maybe your computation would be like hugely.
Okay. That's really interesting. Is it relevant to programming or to machine learning somehow?
Yeah. Well, of course, because most of what we do, I mean, from the linear algebra, from the graph theory, are small components that you can find everywhere in the machine learning, either support vector machine inside the PCA algorithm. So we are teaching the decomposition, which is the base of all these decomposition that are later used in machine learning. So everything which somehow compose the machine learning principles and models, we are trying to explain and give students their understanding of all these components. Yeah. Because that's, I think, distinguish those that are just blindly using neural network. Look, I have a neural network and use it. And those that actually understand what is happening.
Yeah,
that
really sounds interesting. And I think it's very, very relevant to what I teach on the next course, because the next course, what we will present to you, is Introduction to Machine Learning. And Introduction to Machine Learning is something like our key course on machine learning, on master degree. That's a course about the general machine learning. It's mainly about the neural network. That's half of the semester. It's just neural network. The first part of the semester is the background for students, the background of overfitting, overtraining, and other problems relevant and which are in machine learning. It's really key important, and it's really important, and it's really essential to explain what they caused and how they affect what they do. Then we switch on ensemble methods. Ensemble methods, for example, like decision trees, the random forest, and other stuff. Then we move to support vector machines, and I think you will like support vector machines because we teach it really deeply, and we cover how the equation in books are relevant to equation which is in programming language, because it's totally different something. It's a totally different story. The implementation side of support vector machines is something totally different than which is in books.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Then we moved. We move on to neural network world. It's a quite big world.
Yeah, sure.
And we introduce and we do with our students the basic elemental neural network. We are focusing mainly on implementing everything from scratch, just with NumPy, nothing more. Nobody needs TensorFlow for it, because we will use TensorFlow later in the semester on real world cases. And we are doing other architectures of neural network, for example, like convolutional neural network, recurrent neural network, generative adversarial neural network, and transformer neural network. And transformers is it's the most popular, stuff now, because the chat.
Yeah, of course. And you said that this field is developing quite quickly. Yeah. So are you designing new courses? Are there something new?
Yeah, we are designing new courses, and we are changing our courses immediately. For example, the transformer wasn't there in this course 2 years ago. That's quite big new topic, it's really popular now, and it allows students to create neural network which translate one sentence from Czech to English. That's really magical stuff for them. And they really like it. So we add the new stuff like transformers in the last 2 years. And we are preparing some new courses. For example, we are preparing the artificial intelligence and software engineers, engines. This is a course which is about how to create agent which will do some stuff in software or do some stuff in games. Especially in games, it's really easy to explain it because it's opponent in your games and on your computer, and we are focusing how to on topics how to create these engines which will behave in the good way. It that means intelligently, because in the past the these agents was mainly created in the way of rules. But now it's really popular to create them in the way of neural network and other methods and implement this stuff in their decision making. For example, the tactical versus strategical behavior, that's quite a big topic. We have example in the games, for example, like board games, the chess. Yeah, that's.
I mean, I can imagine that this topic could be pretty well connected with this IoT world, that you can actually program some independent agents that all together as a group could fulfill some, you know, some tasks. But I mean, individually it's very simple, simple program, but very successful.
Altogether, it changed the total behavior of the whole program and in affect widely the behavior.
Okay, so according to my experience as a student, later on I was mostly interested in you know, programming courses that I don't know, we have a teacher, and against teacher we were programming some software and trying to beat him in a whatever game, and those who were the most successful win. And okay, do we have any projects like that? Or do we have?
Yeah, we have several projects, and our students still like it.
Of
the
course,
most fun and most essential projects. But the first project, what we teach and what we show our students, is the most important one, what changed the whole world of neural network, and it's really popular data set called NIST. It's the data set with handwritten numbers, and we create with our students purely from scratch a convolutional neural network, which estimate which number is written on the image. And that does not sound so interesting, but the most interesting on this project is that we implement purely from scratch without TensorFlow, without Keras, without PyTorch, just with NumPy. And the students on this projects obtained the knowledge of how the parameters behave, how all this stuff works, and it's really important for them to gain this knowledge, because it shaped them to.
Yeah, exactly. In this way, you can understand deeply what is happening behind, and you are not just the black box user.
Yeah.
I mean, you understand what the Google has in his box, even though it's probably slightly more complicated.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And on the internet, you will find several implementation from scratch of neural network, but this implementation with convolutional neural network.
Yeah, I see.
I think that's big topic for them, and they really like it.
So that's very nice, because this is really the part, even the, you're programming robot or automatic car, you will need it, definitely, to read. What about the game? Because you said that
games.
There could be a game.
We have several games. For example, tic-tac-toe.
I see.
We program and we implement with our students the tic-tac-toe game in the Czech version, or the general version of the tic-tac-toe, just not only with three rows and three columns. The aim of this project is to create AI player. We use for this all implementation from scratch of convolutional neural network, which gain the information from the desk of the game and transfer it from to statistical evolution of the board. And this neural network is used for evaluating the moves, which move is the best. And I will show you an example.
Oh, that's nice.
Because I will show you our implementation, what we did with our student, or what I did with our students.
So that means that then you are playing against the player, and if the player beats you, the students get the point.
Yeah. Something like that. We did a tournament of engines.
Oh, I see. That's even better.
Whose engine won the obtained the most points?
Ah, that's very nice.
And you can now see on your computers the visual side of training.
Ah,
and it's training several agents now, and on each desk play two agents, one against other, and mm-hmm. who lost is cancelled from the back of the agents, and the new agent is created by the evolution algorithm by the mutating from the who wants.
Yeah, I see.
So we can look at it for several hours now. Oh,
yeah, of course, it's very addictive.
I think too. I'll close it. So yeah, this is our tic-tac-toe.
Yeah, okay. This could be very nice if you program some game that is teach student that you have a particle setting and they have to follow some rules. What about some logistic or following cars or something?
Yeah.
I heard something about that.
Yeah. We implemented and we did one project with our students about something interesting about how to train a car to drive between blocks and how to train that car to not collide and to follow predetermined path. Yeah, because there are several freely available codes which will show you how to train a car not to collide with a block. But this is something more there is some more additional value because we have much more complicated the evaluation function, and we add some gates which car must follow. Mm-hmm. And I have the implementation too. And I can show you some cars. Yeah, and you can see that in the first batch or in the first epoch, all cars goes randomly, and now they are starting to follow the blue gates.
Yeah,
the blue gates, and not to hit the red blocks. Yeah, some cars still hit it because it's randomly changing the coefficients, and now we have two cars which goes quite.
So in real world, you will need a lot of cars to actually do it.
In real world, you will need a lot of cars and good insurance, especially if you will try to train it on parking slot.
Okay, so then the students are of course not aware of the maps you can build and you can provide.
Yeah. I think the most additional value on this course or on these projects are the thinking, how to design something, how to think about it, how to obtain a data, how to transform a data, and how to design the evolution algorithm and all the other parameters, because the machine learning and artificial intelligence is still a world of hyperparameters, and there are dozens of hyperparameters which you have to train and you have to predetermine them and explain to users, and it's really important to know what the parameters do and how to set them.
Yeah. So it's interesting. Are students often finishing their studies with some diploma thesis? With the topic of the machine learning.
Yeah. It's really popular. Really popular. There are several. I have something like I have dozens of students who do mainly the machine learning stuff. For example, the students who evaluate the photos and try to find exactly what type of car is in photo, in which condition it is, and try to set a price for the car, like to estimate the possible price. That's quite interesting. Or I have another student who works with X-ray scans. Yeah. Try to estimate what's exactly on that scan. If what does it mean? How to affect the patients and how to interpret it? It's it's quite interesting stories and interesting topics.
Hey, I think we can talk on and on. I mean, it's very, very nice discussion, and we can continue up to a night. But I think we have a limited time only. So thank you very much to discuss the teaching with me on the Unicorn University with me. And I hope we will see each other on the on the open conference again for another topic.
Thank you so much, David. Thank you for having me.
Bye.
Okay. I cannot thank myself.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Davide and Karle. Since Karel is not here, I would ask David. So you talked about gamification and its importance in education. So what are the other obstacles you need to and from the student point of view, you need to go over and fight with?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, some of the courses are, you know, very easy because, as you have seen with Karel, all those AI-based subjects are very easy. You can like create a game and fight students together, etc. So that is not hard. But what could be hard was something that was mentioned as well. It is math. So some of the more mathematical oriented, statistical oriented courses might have some problems because you are teaching and learning as a student something which is very abstract and is very hard to somehow make a game out of it or make it funny. However, we are trying always. If there is a particular thing that, I don't know, eigenvalue decomposition or something that we have in our math, to immediately come up with something that, okay, but look, there is an application that you will need for, and once you will do this on the other course, or maybe immediately here, somewhere in between, somewhere inside this tool, there is this decomposition present.
Yes.
So, and then we run the simulation, then we run the transformation and say, this data has been, I don't know, transformed by PCA or other tool, but inside this tool, you can see that there is a decomposition of this data sets, etc. And then students start to be very, very interested in it because try to understand those things in detail. The same thing is, I don't know, we are teaching, for example, the graph theory. So immediately what we are trying to do to say, look, but there are problems in the real world. If you transform it and if you are capable of doing it, you can solve that very efficiently. However, if you don't know it and you put it to the artificial neural network without any preparation of your problem, you will fail.
We already saw the examples.
Exactly. So this is how we try to motivate students to learn even some harder topics of math and statistics, because they are important, as we heard today from Josef Nový.
Yes.
I guess that this is important topic to know, because then you are the good engineer in AI. So we are trying to attract them and say this is really necessary, because it's inside the tool and it's good idea to understand the tool.
Yes, it's important to do it this way, because you know, the learning curve is pretty steep there. And we can imagine that the boring stuff related to math and statistics could be somehow overwhelming the students. And they see the results, the cars, like we saw here. And now they need to follow the path, which includes those mathematical and statistical things. And on the other hand, they also need to know the programming language, like R and Python.
Exactly.
And what is your opinion on the Python and, for example, Node.js, which is our primary technology?
I know it's a very complicated question and even more complicated answer. Of course, what we are trying to teach them, it doesn't really matter what language you will learn, because that's what I'm always arguing, that now you will learn something, but believe me, in 10 years there will be something else you will be using, right? Because I started to learn on completely different languages that I'm using today. So probably if you learn Python, there will be something else like Julia, and because everyone would adopt the language advantages, and probably the Python could be substituted, or even R, because there will be new and better languages. Maybe more popular is better to say, right? Yes, because sometimes it's not about better language. So the basic idea what we are trying to do, and it has been mentioned today as well, that we are trying to learn them how to make algorithms, how to think algorithmic way to solve the problems. And the fact that in the end, you will type it in R, Python, etc., is regardless. I mean, that's not important in the end. Well, there is one thing that we are trying to optimize, in fact, is that how easy are some stuff. So if you would like to, I don't know, compute with vectors and many algebraic stuff, that we turn to a specific language that everything is easy in it. If you want a more statistical thing, that again, turn to R or other languages that are more compatible or slightly better in sense of writing code for statistical tasks. Of course, it depends again, because some people are... even the Node.js can be interesting, because I know that I have several lectures in cryptography, and in fact the students were not aware of any other language, or I mean I should not presume that they are aware of other language. So we were doing cryptography in Node.js. That sounds a little crazy, but it is possible.
Yes, but on the other hand, for the today's world, it means that the people should learn the basics behind the AI. Then they need to know the programming language. Then they need to know the architecture where they will program the stuff. And in the end, it creates a complex environment and ecosystem. And it's really important to help the people with this stuff, because on the other hand, they will not be effective. And if we, as much as technologies are available, we will involve in this, it will be pretty hard for them to be effective and to deliver their solutions in a shorter time.
Definitely. That's why we are teaching the Python and R in parallel, in some sense, and even the math, I was speaking about, anything that we are describing, immediately we are showing, okay, look, but there is a library in Python that you can use and do it, let the computer do for you. So that's nice, because they can control whether they understand the math correctly.
Okay,
just try it.
Okay.
I think
that's from my side everything.
Yes, so thank you for questions, and thank you. Thank all the presenters except myself, because I cannot think to myself. And I hope that it was a great day.